Hello friends, welcome to GT Science tutorial. In this video, I am going to explain about collision theory of unimolecular reaction. This theory is also called Lindemann's theory. In my previous video, I have already explained about collision theory of bimolecular reaction, whose link you can find in the description below. So what actually happens in case of unimolecular reaction and how does this reaction proceed? So in this video, we are going to see Lindemann's theory and we are going to see the derivation related to it. So without wasting any time, let's start. Collision theory of unimolecular reaction was given by Lindemann himself. So this theory is called Lindemann's theory, and he proved this theory on the basis of or with the help of bimolecular reaction. So he used bimolecular reaction theory to prove the unimolecular reaction. Okay, so he used the help of bimolecular reaction. He considered a reactant A, okay, and he collided that same reactant with another A, and that formed an intermediate complex, okay, and that intermediate complex finally formed product. That intermediate complex finally formed the product. So this reaction, he tried to say that not all the molecules that are activated convert into the product. According to bimolecular collision, the reactant that gains certain amount of energy to bypass the threshold energy convert into the product. But Lindemann said that not all the molecules that are activated convert into the product. But there happens a certain phenomenon by which all the molecules cannot convert into the product. So what is that phenomenon? Let me erase these things and then we will write that, okay? So Lindemann's theory states that not all the molecules that are activated convert into the product, but only those molecules that remain active for a long period of time convert into the product. According to this statement, we can know that there exists a time lag between activation of the molecule and the formation of product. Okay, so when the molecules are activated, then after certain time only they convert into the product. So what happens in that time lag? Some phenomenon happens in that time lag due to which the reaction, not all the molecules that are activated can form the product. Okay, so during the time lag, some activated molecules collide with the reactants and gets deactivated. gets deactivated. So this is the thing, okay? During that time lag, okay, some of the activated molecules again react with or again collide with the initial reactant, and they finally end up converting itself into the reactant again. So all the molecules, among all the molecules, those activated molecules that collide with the reactant will convert into the reactant itself, okay? But only those few activated molecules that do not collide with the reactant will finally end up being the product, okay? That's why not all the molecules that are activated by the collision convert into the product, because during that time lag, they again can collide with the reactant and convert into the reactant itself, okay? So let us try to understand this by the reaction and the derivation, okay? So let me erase this all. Let us consider a general reaction, okay? Let us consider a general reaction, which says, let us react this A with A itself, okay? A is the reactant, and which forms the activated complex, okay? First of all, let me write the complete reaction, then we will understand. Okay, so this is the complete reaction. Here the rate constant is K1, it will be K2, and it will be K3. Now we have written two reactions. The first reaction is trying to say that when reactants collide, some of the molecules will get activated, okay? Now the forward reaction is denoted by this arrow, the upper arrow, and the rate constant here is K1, okay? Now during that time lag, some of the activated molecule will again collide with the reactant, and they again convert into the reactants, right? So they react with this and they again convert into the reactant. During this process happens during that time lag, okay, between the activation of the molecule and formation of the product, there exists certain time lag. During that time lag, this procedure happens, okay? So this is the backward reaction for this reaction, and the rate constant here is K2, okay? So this is the reversible reaction. The first part is the reversible reaction. Now few of the activated molecules, let us consider this is the few of the activated molecule, okay, that did not collide with the reactant, they finally end up being the product, okay? And its rate constant is K3. I hope you understood the reaction, okay? If you did not understand the reaction, then please rewind the video and watch again, okay? So now let me erase all these so that we can proceed the derivation. Okay, I just wrote the reaction one more time because we are going to take help of these reactions, okay? Now if we talk about the rate of reaction, then we can get the rate of reaction from this reaction only, because this reaction is completely useless for us, because this is the reversible reaction. We are not getting any product from here. So the rate of reaction completely depends on this reaction, okay? Because product is formed here. So from this reaction, the rate of reaction, that is denoted by dA by dt, okay, will be equal to, rate of reaction is always the product of rate constant. Here the rate constant is K3 and the concentration of the reactant. So for this particular reaction, A asterisk is behaving as the reactant, okay? Now we are going to put a negative sign over here. This is because there is the reversible reaction. Due to the reversible reaction, some activated molecules are again converted into the reaction, okay? The reaction is going back in backward direction. That's why we put a negative sign over here. I hope you understood this much. Now as we know that there is the formation of activated molecule, so steady state approximation principle can be applied on it, okay? Let us consider this as equation number one. As there is the formation, of activated complex, or you can say intermediate as well, okay, activated complex, then स्टेडी स्टेट अप्रोक्सीमेशन प्रिंसिपल कैन बी यूज्ड, ओके, कैन बी अप्लाइड ओवर हियर. सो व्हाट डज स्टेडी स्टेट अप्रोक्सीमेशन प्रिंसिपल सेज? इट सेज दैट when the activated molecule exists in low concentration, the rate of formation of that activated molecule is equal to the rate of consumption of that activated molecule. First of all, we need to calculate the formula for the rate of formation of A asterisk. Okay, so rate of formation of A asterisk will be equal to, now we need to see these two reactions and where is A asterisk being formed. Here, this is the only reaction where A asterisk is being formed, right? When we consider the forward reaction, that is the rate constant K1, okay? So, it will be K1, and if you talk about the reactants, there are two reactions and both of them are same. So, if you multiply them, we will get this type of form. So this is the rate of formation of A asterisk. Again, rate of consumption of A asterisk. Now, for the rate of consumption, we need to see where the A asterisk is already being used. Okay, the A asterisk is being used in the reaction. It is behaving as the reactant. So here also it is behaving as reactant because in backward reaction, these two are the reactants, isn't it? So it will be K2 into A asterisk into A, right? Plus here also A asterisk is behaving as a reactant. So it will be K3 multiplies A asterisk. Okay. So finally, we get this type of form in rate of consumption of A asterisk. Now, we are going to make them equal because a steady state approximation principle says that rate of formation of A asterisk will be equal to rate of consumption of A asterisk. So let me erase all these so that we can proceed the reaction. So from steady state approximation principle, we can equate them, okay? So it will be, therefore, it will be K1. A square will be equal to K2 A asterisk into A plus K3 A asterisk. Okay. Now, from this equation, we are going to calculate the value for A asterisk. So, what can we write? K1 A square will be equal to, let's take this common. Okay. We will get K2 A asterisk K2 concentration of A plus K3, okay, and this will be A asterisk. Okay, now to find the value of A asterisk, we need to divide this term by this term. We need to take this to left hand side, so we will get directly I am writing, okay, A asterisk will be equal to K1 A square by K2 A plus K3. And let us consider this is equation number 2. Let me erase this all unnecessary part, okay? Now, we finally got this much value, okay? Now, let us put this value in that equation number 1. What was equation number 1? Let me write over here, minus dA by dt equals K3 into A asterisk, right? So, this was equation number 1. Let us put this value in equation number 1. So, from 1 and 2, from 1 and 2, we are calculating for that one, dA by dt will be equal to K3 into, let us put the value of A asterisk in that equation. So it will be K1 A square by K2 A plus K3. Okay. Now, what we can do here, there are many constant, right? There is K1, K3 by K2 and then A square by K2A plus K3. So we get this type of form. If we have three constants, okay, that is in multiplication and division form, so we can replace them by a special constant or by a big constant. So we are writing k, let us consider k is this value k1 into k3 by k2, and we get a square by k2 a plus k3. So this is actually minus dA by dt, okay, where this big k is k1 k3 by k2. Okay, so this is our final formula. Now we need to consider two cases. So what are those cases? Let's see that. In first case, let us consider the condition in which this value is much greater than this value. That is, let k2a is much greater than k3. So according to the rule of mathematics, the very small value can be neglected. So in this case, k3 can be neglected. So we get the equation. If we neglect this value, we get this much value. Okay, now these two can be cut, and there are two constants, so we can write another constant, and we get this type of form. Therefore, we finally get an equation of the type this. Okay, so from this equation, it is clear that this reaction depends on concentration FA, and it is a first order reaction. Okay, it is a first order reaction, and this condition appears when the rate of reactivation of the complex is smaller than or lower than the rate of deactivation of the complex. So in this case, the rate of deactivation is more than the rate of activation, okay, of A asterisk. So therefore, it is a first order reaction. Now let's see the second case. In second case, let us consider the condition in which this value is much greater than this value. That is, let k3 is much greater than k2a. Okay, then similarly, k2a can be what? Neglected. Okay, k2a can be neglected. So we get minus dA by dt equals kA square by k3, and these two are constant terms, so we can write kA square, and we finally get an equation of the form dA by dt will be equal to kA square. Okay, I'm sorry, the square should be here, and we get this as our final term. Okay, Now from this equation, it is clear that it is a second order reaction, and to be this reaction, there must be the condition in which the rate of activation should be higher. So in this case, the rate of activation is more than the rate of deactivation of A asterisk. Okay, and this is a second order reaction. So I hope you understood this much. That's all in this video. If you like the video, please share this video as much as you can. Thank you for watching the video.